Welcome back, students. Welcome to our next session, session number 10. The topic is the Roman image by R.K. Narayan. And this topic is prescribed for third semester BSc, Bengaluru North University. Let us go to the recap of our previous session. In the last session, session number 9, we saw short story as a literary genre. There are many types of literature, like short story, novel, novella, poem, poetry. Okay, these are all different genres, different types in English literature. So as a novel, as poetry, short story is also a type of literature. It is one of the literary genres that we discussed in the last class. And R.K. Narayan, we heard about R.K. Narayan. He was born in the year 1906. And he passes away in the year 2001. And he is one of the universally acclaimed short story writers in India, especially from South India. And we also learned that he is the creator of fictitious town called Malgudi. Malgudi has become so famous, popular in India. And Shankar Nag, the director and producer of Malgudi Days, popularized R.K. Narayan's short stories in the in the vision media. R.K. Narayan wrote about common people and about day-to-day life. His characters are from common society, ordinary people. And the day-to-day life was the focus of his short stories and novellas. And at the same time, in all his writings, almost all his novels, there's been a subtle humor and a depiction of commoners' problems. So we see a subtle humor hovering behind his stories. And we also saw how brief moments of belief and change that bring out changes in human attitude. A brief moment of changes, within a fraction of a second, changes may happen, right? And that is not in our hand. So we can be popular within a night, or that popularity can be destroyed within a few hours. Okay, changes are there. And they tend to happen in everyone's life, okay? And those changes definitely bring out a major change in human attitude that we are going to see in the short story, The Roman Image. And also, we discussed about the hard work of the main characters in the story and destruction of that long-lasting hard work, the effort, the endeavor put in is going to be destroyed within seconds. Okay, so that our short story is going to reflect. And without much delay, dear students, let us start. The topic, our today's topic is The Roman Image by R.K. Narayan. Let us go to contextual interpretation. Before we go to the core of the short story, let us learn in this session contextual interpretation of the story, The Roman Image. Here, the talkative man, the hero of the story, one of the major characters of the story. Of course, recurring characters, all pervading characters are the archaeologist and the talkative man. These two are the major characters. And the talkative man is the narrator of the story. Okay, talkative man is also the narrator of the story, one who tells the story to the readers. And Arkanarayan doesn't mention his name. He calls him as a talkative man. And the narration of the story is in first person. There are three persons in English language. First person, that is I. Second person, that is you. And third person, represented by he or she or it. Okay, the story is narrated in the first person throughout. And the talkative man's interest in probing and exploring is very important in the story. Okay, so in the beginning of the story itself, the talkative man himself declares that he is interested in probing and exploring the antiquities in southern India. That means he has keen interest in excavations, in archaeological works. Okay, God helps him by sending the archaeologist, one of the famous archaeologists, to Malgudi town. This talkative man resides in Malgudi, and he is much interested in probing and exploring the antiquities. And of course, the archaeologist enters in the story. The archaeologist's name is also not mentioned. Arkanarayan just addresses him as the doctor or the archaeologist. The famous archaeologist, he is not only really popular in India, he is also popular in abroad. He is also popular in other countries, that is in the world. Okay, so world popular, universally acclaimed archaeologist is going to come to Malgudi. Right, so that has become the source of interest to our talkative man. And as I have already told you, the archaeologist has been unnamed but addressed as the doctor. The archaeologist's aspiration to excel the excavators of Mohenjo-daro is another point in the story. Mohenjo-daro, you all know about Mohenjo-daro civilization, one of the ancient civilizations that has been mentioned in the history. Okay, we all history students study about Mohenjo-daro civilization, Indus Valley civilization, Mohenjo-daro civilization, Mesopotamian civilization. You must have heard in your school days. You must have learned those civilizations in your history sociology classes in schools, and in your PU also. This archaeologist has got an aspiration. He has an ambition. What is that? He has to excel. His effort, his work has to excel the excavators of Mohenjo-daro. That is his ambition. That is his aspiration. Okay, in his life, and that aspiration, that ambition, definitely within a few days or a few months is going to be devastated, by the changes that take place in the story. An archaeological survey in Malgudi district takes place as soon as the archaeologist enters Malgudi, the town, and they particularly camp in Siral village on the banks of Sarayu. Okay, Sarayu River has been mentioned in the story. Sarayu plays a very important role, and it recurs throughout the story. And Siral village also. Siral village also plays a very important role, and it is a recurring theme turn into of the story. And archaeologist comes to Malgudi. He meets our talkative man. He employs him as his assistant with a meager amount of salary and wage. And now talkative man has become the assistant of the archaeologist. Archaeologist and our talkative man as his assistant and his team, archaeologist team, have camped on the bank of Sarayu in the village called Siral village in southern part of India. A piece of glass which is Florentian, which is discovered as Florentian of 5 AD 85. Okay, so of course you all know already that talkative man is very much interested in probing and exploring, and archaeologist's company, our talkative man has become one of the excavators, great excavators, experienced excavators. And archaeologist says, tells to him that not a single antique piece, however valued it is, however less or however great it is, it should not be overlooked. Okay, there has been strict order from the archaeologist. So as a sixth, as his order, Tocatinman very honestly and sincerely follows the order of the archaeologist, and he doesn't allow even a small glass piece or even a small earthen piece get missed from his notice. So they discover a piece of glass and surrender it to the archaeologist. Archaeologist observes it with his magnifying lens seriously studying that piece of glass. He declares finally that it is a Florentian glass piece of 5 AD. Okay, and this has been a turning point in the story and in lives of the archaeologist and our talkative man as well. Very importantly, talkative man's life, this is going to be a milestone. And one exhilarating evening, while bathing in the river Sarayu, the talkative man brings out a niche. Okay, this glass piece, Florentian, which is declared as Florentian piece. Archaeologist says that the southern part of this Siral village and Sarayu river area, it must be related to the Roman Empire. That is why our excavation and our work should be done very intensely here onwards. Okay, so for that reason, the whole team starts very deeply excavating and probing and observing each piece, whatever they get, okay, and they'll never miss a single piece of glass or say a single earthen piece. One exhilarating evening, what happens? Our talkative man enjoys bathing in the river, especially Sarayu River. Okay, so one evening he was bathing in the river Sarayu, and when he dives into the river, he goes down, and his fingers touch an image, okay, hard thing, and he brings it out, and that hard thing turns out to be an image. Okay, so this is also one of the important stage in the short story. Next, what happens? The image's description. Okay, image's description takes place in the story. The height of the image, the width of the image, and our archaeologist is a hard worker, very strenuous worker he is, and the whole night he observes with his magnifying glass. The whole night he will be awake observing that image. Image is a statue. Okay, and he declares that the statue belongs to a Roman emperor. Okay, archaeological study of the image by the doctor till 3 o'clock in the night. Actually, it is going to be morning. In the morning, leads to a declaration by the doctor that the image is a Roman statue of the Roman emperor Tiberius II. Okay, and he also announces there is a link between Roman history and the history of southern India. Okay, so the image which is discovered by, which is brought out by our talkative man, is announced now, is declared as the image or the statue of the Roman Emperor Tiberius II. Roman Emperor Tiberius II is very important. Okay, remember it. And then what happens, within a few hours, talkative man and the archaeologist are going to be very popular, and their names are going to be in the mouths of all Indians. Okay, and the popularity starts now. All papers, periodicals came and visited these two, the whole team, and they published in their papers about this image, Roman image. Okay, and the picture of the image, the description, all that will be published within few days by all the periodicals, by all the papers in India. The popularity of the doctor and the narrator, talkative man, takes place within 2 months. Within 2 months, they have become world famous. universally acclaimed. Okay, and hard work with history, archaeology, epigraphy, and preparing a monograph, all this take place within a short period of time. Our talkative man has become so busy now. Okay, he is working hard with Indian history as well as Roman history, archaeological objects, archaeological information, okay, and epigraphy. And as a result of all this, our talkative man is preparing a monograph, okay, a mammoth monograph he is going to prepare. Okay, archaeologist, of course, he was helping him in the beginning, but later he tells to the talkative man that he has work to be continued in north part of India, saying that he goes back to his place in the north part of India, and the monograph's responsibility falls on the shoulders of our talkative man. Okay, he alone leads the team. He sits in the library day and night, works with that monograph. The doctor going back to North India and the narrator's hard work in the library. Which library? Madras Library. Okay. The then Madras. Now it is called as Chennai. Okay. It is renamed as Chennai. During the British administration, British India, Chennai was called as Madras. The whole of South India was called as Madras Regiment. Okay, there was no Karnataka, there was no Tamil Nadu or Kerala. The whole South India was called as Madras Regiment under British administration, British India. Right? Now, the talkative man is working very hard in the library in Madras. Right. So, now, after our talkative man has almost come to the end of the monograph, so he has finished his monograph, and after such a long endeavor, after such long hard work, he calls the archaeologist and informs him that the work is finished. Okay, and the archaeologist feels so happy and tells our talkative man to take holiday, go enjoy the vacation. Okay, go to some hill station, enjoy after this long hours of hard work. But our talkative man doesn't go anywhere. No, he doesn't go to any hill station. Rather, he comes back to Siral village to take bath in the Sarayu river. Okay, he enjoys that, right? And the narrator's return to Siral village is one of the other milestones in the story. And there he meets a local man, okay, a native. He meets a native on the bank of Sarayu in Siral village. That is also one of the important steps in the short story. And there is also a subtle humor with the heathen, right? And villager, the native man, and our talkative man, both of them sit on the steps of Sarayu, okay, on the bank of the river. They sit on the river step and both of them talk casually. They begin talking casually. Villager, the native, informs the talkative man, our talkative man informs the villager about the image, and then villager gets doubt. Okay, so what kind of image you are talking about? How come Roman image? He doesn't know anything. He is a local man and he is not that studied also. He doesn't have much education. I think he has not gone to any school or college. And he just gives a very important information and a very shocking information to our talkative man, to our narrator. So according to local man, the image doesn't belong to any Roman emperor or Tiberius II or anyone, but it belongs to the shrine of Marikamba, Mari goddess of the village. Okay, villager shockingly tells to the talkative man that the image is one of the Dwarapalakas of Marikamba shrine of the village. Marikamba shrine is a small shrine in the village, and Dwarapalakas are there alongside of the shrine, and this image is one of the Dwarapalakas. What is the proof? the tough demon is not going to believe it. Of course, villager is going to take him to the shrine and show him that one Dwarapalaka is missing, and the same Dwarapalaka, he has taken it, and the archaeologist has mistaken it as the Roman Emperor Tiberius II. So that is the humor interwoven in the story, and that is a twist also. That is the change, the great change in the story. Villagers and villager also narrates the story of the drunkard priest of Marish shrine, and how come this Dwarapalaka has gone into the riverbed, Sarayu river. Okay, who threw it? Okay, anyway, it cannot walk. The statue cannot walk. That is why the villager narrates the talkative man and the story of the drunkard priest. There is a priest. There was a priest in the shrine, Marikamba shrine, and that priest was a drunkard, alcoholic, and that drunkard priest, damaged the statue, and he threw it into the river. That is the real story. And the drunkard priest's hallucination regarding the Dwarapalaka. I mean, in detail, the villager tells him the story, how drunkard priest under his alcoholic hallucination damaged the Dwarapalaka, and how under his hallucination Dwarapalaka used to beat him, whack him, there was a fight between the Dwarapalaka and the drunkard priest, and finally he threw it into the river. There was a fight between the Dwarapalakas and the drunkard priest, and he threw it into the river. Okay. Next, narrator's sincere sharing of the disastrous information with the doctor. Of course, this is the disastrous information. Very shocking and awe-inspiring and disastrous, devastating information. So narrator, without fail, with his honesty, sincerely, he informs the archaeologist that the statue doesn't belong to Roman Emperor Tiberius II, but it belongs to the Marikamba shrine of Siral village. Okay, it is a local statue which was there in the small shrine of Marikamba in Siral village. And what happens? What is the reaction? What should be the reaction of the archaeologist? Archaeologist has a great popularity all over the world, and he himself declared that the statue belongs to Tiberius II, and there is a link. There must be a link between Roman emperor and southern India. So what should be the repercussion? What should be the result of all this? So sincerity, honesty overtakes all. Okay, at the end, the archaeologist instructs the narrator, the talkative man, to throw the image. Okay, to throw the image into the fire. Why? Because he doesn't want to be proved as fools in the eyes of the Indians, in the eyes of the people. Okay, he doesn't want to be proved as a fool. Okay, before we prove to be fools, throw the image into the fire. That is the instruction given by the doctor. The image is finally thrown into the sea. Okay, the narrator doesn't burn it, but he throws into the sea. Why? Because image should not come back again, right? It should not come back. And it should not mislead others like how it did to the talkative man and the great doctor. So that is why he threw it into the sea. Not to the river, into the sea. Remember it. And so this is the end of the session, students. And before we end the session, let us see what is the intention of the author behind all this. Behind all this theme and plot. So the primary purpose is, the primary purpose of the author is to inform the readers how inevitably mistakes can happen in life in spite of hard work. So there is no point, there is no objection. Archaeologist is very hardworking, and talkative man is also very hardworking. Okay, there is no objection in it at all, right? And in spite of all this, nevertheless, mistakes tend to happen, right? The great archaeologist has done the mistake, and our talkative man, who is so interested in probing and exploring, who is how to say a hard worker, right, tend to do mistakes. The wrong is done, the mistake is done. So that is the primary purpose of the story. And next, the tone of the story is ironic and subtly humorous. Okay, there is a subtle humor and there is irony also. Okay, so author is, the writer has been ironic in describing the archaeologist, in describing the talkative man, especially the archaeologist. Okay, so the great archaeologist has done such a simple mistake, such a petty mistake. So that kind of irony is there, right? And subtle humor is also there. How great things can end up in petty, meanest things. And next point, a person, no matter how popular or famous, an unexpected change may happen. There is a possibility, okay? Change may happen in everybody's life, however great they are, however small they are, however mean they are. And those changes definitely shake, okay? Shake that person, however great he is. Those changes can shake him, can change his fate or popularity. And they can put any kind of a person into a hiding place. Those changes can put any great person into a hidden place, right? Into secrecy. So that's what happens at the end. And the archaeologists, of course, they all become popular within humans, but he wants to be hidden. When the image proves to be not the Roman emperor's image, but a local image, Dwarapalaka's image of Marikamba's shrine in Siral village, right? So that is why he wants to be hidden. He wants to be away from the popularity. So in a simple way. And the story, I mean, all this inculcates the spirit of stoic nature. Of course, all these things, twists and turns, changes, right? And all these things, bring in us the stoic nature. We should be stoic, however, changed the situation maybe, and success will come and failure also will come. Okay, so in the time of difficulty, in the time of happiness, we should be sane. We should receive happiness and failures, difficulties in the same way, in a very stoic manner, in a very balanced manner. So that balance, that stoic nature is what required among as human beings, right? So you can take home this lesson from this story. The stoic nature is what we require at this present situation. And it also teaches the readers that it is better to be hidden behind the leaf, okay? It is better to be hidden behind the leaf instead of being fooled in the public. So which is greater in intensity? Whether being fooled in the public or being hidden behind the leaf, right? Elemare elirozenghal tarala, elemare kai tara. So that is why archaeologist prefers the former one, the first one. Yeah, so the Roman image is the story of fame, honesty, enthusiasm, and of course, the change, right? So, futility of fame, popularity, aspiration, ambition against unexpected change is the main theme of the Roman image. Yes, it is the main theme of our story, the Roman image. How fame, popularity become futile within a fraction of a second. That is how changes may happen in life. Okay, that is a major theme. And there is also a concern that in any crucial time, honesty is preferred. Okay, honesty is needed in any crucial time. If you are honest, if you are sincere, definitely you can escape from the difficult situation. You can, I mean, escape is not the proper word here. Rather, you can save yourself. You can defend yourself from the difficult situation. Right? There is a concern that in any crucial time, honesty can save you. Sincerity can save you. So that is the main thing. That is one of the main themes of the story. And understanding of negative and positive changes in life. Okay, changes are there. Of course, changes will be there. Change is the order of the day. Change is the tendency of nature. And change can also be negative. Changes can also be positive. Okay, we should equally receive them. We should equally receive both positive and negative changes. That stoic quality is required among us all. The narrator believes that his opportunity of becoming an excavator can make him popular in the world. Of course, narrator strongly believes that he has become the excavator with the help of the archaeologist, and it may change his life. He believes that, but that doesn't happen, right? And of course, it is not in our hands. And there is an inference at the end that even in hard work, unavoidable mistakes can happen. Okay, however hard you work, however sincere in your work, mistakes unavoidable. Mistakes are unavoidable. They happen, and you should be ready to accept that. Such mistakes are better to be hidden. Okay, if mistakes happen, better to hide them. Being sincere, being honest. Okay, so instead of being proved as a fool, better to be hidden. Better to be go away. Okay, so that is the end. That is the inference that the ending of the story gives you. So with the students, I am going to end session number 10. So let us go in the next session. Let us go to the short story in detail. Okay, that is the heart of our next session. So thank you all for listening to me.